Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Long Beach Homebuyer Workshop. My name is Jason Maida. It's great to be with you this evening. Tonight, we're going to take you through our first-time homebuyer workshop, and I'm really excited to bring this content to you. We're going to get started right now. I know we have quite a few of you that are going to be joining into the session here, but we'll go ahead and get going just for time's sake. Now, just want to remind everybody, this is a very interactive workshop. We really encourage questions as we move through tonight's content. If you use the Q&A function in Zoom, myself or Ken Fleck, we'll be able to answer your questions on air, and we'll kind of share those back with the group. We're really excited to bring this information to you. We've been in partnership now with Long Beach just over a year in our alumni group, and really excited to be able to support you in homeownership. So as we move through tonight's content, we get a chance to share with you all the great tools and resources that are available to you as part of our partnership. Just a quick little bit about me. My name is Jason Maida. I get a chance to host these workshops every couple of weeks on Zoom. We teach these all across the state. And I specialize in first-time buyer lending. So for those of you that are joining tonight's class and are first-time buyers, you're in the right spot because you're going to hopefully get a lot of great tips and resources on the process, credit, and different resources that are available to you from a program perspective. We are going to spend a little bit of time tonight talking about the CalHFA program. If you've been kind of looking at some of the local news outlets, whether you're in LA or Long Beach or maybe down in Orange County, there's a big spotlight on some of the CalHFA affordable housing programs that are available. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that this evening in the latter part of tonight's discussion. So we also spend some time looking at some of the core programs, conventional loans, FHA, USDA, VA loans. Spend some time looking also at some of the jumbo loan financing options too. Okay, here's tonight's talking points. We're going to look at the housing market in just a bit. We're going to kind of take and do a rent versus buying analysis. We're going to speak about interest rates. Lots are going on with interest rates because it remains a volatile market with interest rates. We'll take a look at credit. Some student loans and how that can impact you from a qualifying perspective. We'll look at loan programs, how a lender will qualify you from both an income and asset perspective. And as I mentioned, we're going to talk about some of the low and moderate income assistance programs available through CalHFA. So we'll do that this evening. And then finally, we'll kind of wrap up tonight's discussion looking at the process of buying a house. So many of you have probably heard about pre-approval. So we'll kind of walk you through the stages of what does it look like from pre-approval all the way to step six when you're purchasing, or sorry, getting the keys to your house, and also take you through what a consultation looks like. Okay, so that's kind of tonight's discussion points. Now we want to kind of launch in tonight's workshop about, you know, first of all, looking at the benefits of buying, because first of all, buying is probably going to be one of the largest investments we make in our lifetime. And, you know, it doesn't always make sense for everyone. And so I think that's why it's really important for us to do some budgeting and just to do some goal setting to make sure that we're going to be in the best possible position and that buying is something that's going to be sustainable for us. So when we think about the benefits of buying, you know, it creates ability for stability in our housing payment. This is going to be an asset. So you have the ability to be able to pass along that asset to the heirs of your estate. Potential growth in wealth, because when you look at equity in a home, that's the difference of what you owe on a house versus what that market value of the home is. And then there's some tax benefits that come along with owning a home. So a lot of great things that come about with being involved in home ownership. And as we think about home ownership, I want to kind of take you through a rent versus buying calculator. So we can kind of look at like what we're currently paying right now in rent versus what that could look like in terms of mortgage. So this calculator that we're going to walk through is the Freddie Mac calculator. And by the way, all the material that we share with you this evening, we're going to send out to you via email tomorrow morning. So Ken Fleck on our team is going to send that out to you. And you'll be able to have all these resources available to you. Now, I want to walk you through this calculator now, because you know, I think as we look at setting some goals for homeownership, it really does start with budgeting to make sure that we can, you know, buy a home affordably and sustainably for ourselves. So let's first kind of look at some of these fields that we're going to add or that we're going to make inputs to. So from the current standpoint of renting, we're going to plug in our rent. Let's say we're paying about $2,500 a month in rent, right? We'll assume monthly renter's insurance of $15 per month. And then let's assume the rent is going to go up by about 3% per year. Okay. Home purchase, we'll open that tab. I'm going to put, for this discussion, I'm going to put $600,000 is my purchase price. Now, I know that's going to vary based upon where you're at in California, whether you're going to buy in Irvine versus, you know, deciding to buy maybe in San Bernardino or Long Beach, whatever the case may be. And then we're going to assume a down payment. I'm going to put 5% for right now. Now, as we're going to learn a little bit later, the minimum down payment at $600,000 in purchase price is 3%. But for this kind of exercise we're going to go through, we'll put 5%. Property taxes, we're going to estimate those right around, we'll keep them at $7,250. I think that's a pretty fair number. Typically, when we calculate property taxes from a lending standpoint, we're going to usually use 1.25% of the purchase price, and then we're going to divide that by 12, and that gives us a monthly figure. So that's going to be put into our budget. Homeowners insurance, that's going to protect our home against, you know, vandalism, fire, potentially flood if you're in a flood zone. So we're gonna factor in homeowners insurance into our budget. And then maintenance. Maintenance we have slotted at $2,000 annually. Of course, if we maybe purchase an older home that requires a little bit more upkeep, that maintenance cost could be a little bit more expensive. So those are things we want to take into consideration. And then for our loan information, we're going to plug in a 30-year fixed mortgage. We're going to assume an interest rate of 5.5%. Now, we're going to talk about interest rates in just a bit because there's a lot to talk about there. But right now, we're going to put in 5.5% for tonight's discussion. Origination charges, that's the part of your overall closing costs. Origination charges are going to be what a lender is going to charge you. Now, with American Pacific Mortgage, we typically have a $995 underwriting fee and a $910 processing fee. Now, for those of you that are part of our Long Beach Alumni Partnership, we do discount our processing fee. So normally it's $910. That gets dropped down to $160 with our $750 discount. So really cool opportunity there. And discount points allows you as a consumer to be able to buy down your interest rate to a lower level. Typically 1 point equals 1% of your loan amount. So just to make the math easy, if I'm going to finance $600,000 and I pay 1 point, that's $6,000. Potentially that cost that I pay additionally of $6,000 could bring down my rate 0.25%. Usually 1 point equals 0.25% reduction in interest rate. Not the exact, but it's typically that way. And then finally, other settlement charges. That's also part of your closing costs. That could be title and escrow fees, transfer taxes, home warranties, things that are all involved in a home purchase. And once you actually have an accepted offer on a home, those are line items that we would review as part of your disclosures. Typically, closing costs are going to range around 2 to 3% of your sales price. So when you're doing some kind of calculations of what my savings needs to look like, not only are we going to have our down payment, so let's say 5%. So in this case, 5% on $600,000 is $30,000. So not only do I need my $30,000, but I'm also going to need my funds for my closing costs of 2 to 3% of the purchase price. Okay. And the last thing we want to look at is the other assumptions. We're going to assume an appreciation of about 3% of our home. So the home hopefully goes up 3%. If for existing homeowners, you know, we've probably seen 10 to 12% appreciation annualized, but we want to be a little more conservative when we're projecting out our budget. Expected years of the home, 7 years, selling costs of 8%. What that means is when we eventually sell our home in 7 years, we're going to pay the cost of a realtor, as well as closing costs. So we want to factor that in because that's going to come out of our sales proceeds of the home. And then finally, the state and federal tax rate, 33.8, and then the savings rate of 1%. So when we kind of plug in all these data points, what this tells us is that we're going to continue to pay rent of $2,500 a month. We continue to do that and the rent rises on average. I think we had what 3% increase versus our mortgage payment. Now, our mortgage payment's going to be a lot higher, right? Because we have taxes, insurance, so it's about $4,400 a month. We realize that that's going to be about a $1,900 difference a month. However, my total cost over 7 years in comparing continue to rent versus buying, it's about a $49,000 opportunity of buying versus renting. And how that is calculated based upon tax deduction, and then appreciation in my home. Assuming over 7 years. Now, everybody's scenario is going to look a little bit different, but at least this would be a great tool to be able to help kind of give you some benchmarks to get started in the process as you're doing some goal setting for homeownership. Okay, so that's the Freddie Mac rent versus buy calculator. Okay, so I'm going to go and continue on. Now I want to talk a little bit about housing appreciation. I just mentioned to you in our calculator that we're projecting out 3% appreciation. Clearly, the market has been at a much higher rate than that. And, you know, really, this slide kind of depicts that. As we look at this slide, and this kind of takes a snapshot of the greater LA, Long Beach, Glendale area, and we see kind of the trajectory in housing in those areas, obviously a pretty rapid move upward here. And what that's correlated to is obviously it's kind of at the start of the pandemic in 2020, we really saw the housing market really vault even further further north. What's led to that? Obviously at that time, unprecedented lows in interest rates. We had very low inventory levels of homes, but high demand. So that obviously led to, you know, a supply and demand challenge. So you have low supply, high demand, pushing prices up. And then beyond that, in interest rates, we had a changed work environment, right? So as many of us started staying at home, you know, that kind of, you know, had a lot of consumers re-examine what they want to do in terms of a work-life balance. And so many people decided to stay at home and work and then maybe choose to actually own something that they plan to work out of. So all that led to just a huge demand in housing. And really, we just don't have enough inventory to support that demand. And so that's why we've seen these pretty rapid movements in appreciation. Now, what we're starting to see in the market is shifting a little bit because as you can see this kind of upward trajectory, there's a little bit of a curve here. And we might see a little bit of a flattening here, but certainly maybe a slowdown from what we're seeing on this trajectory. Why that is because I think, you know, we're starting to see sellers that are not getting the same price that they expected on the market. So we're starting to see some price cuts available or happening. And some of that is driven by just not enough data to support these higher priced homes because these homes are getting bid up so high. So we're seeing a little bit of a shift in the market. The other thing that's attributed to that is what's going on from an interest rate perspective. Interest rates over the last 3 months have vaulted up well over 2% of the previous same time year rates. So that's changed buyers' purchasing power quite a bit. And so, you know, some buyers have decided to kind of go on the sidelines. So there's not as much buyer activity in certain properties. And so that is super helpful for those of you that are thinking about going on that journey towards homeownership. So it's starting to thin out the level of competition. But certainly from a rate standpoint, with rates going up, that's changed our purchasing power. So maybe the client that was able to qualify for that $600,000 purchase last year at a rate of, you know, 3.5%, we're looking at rates of 5.5% rate or 5.25, that diminishes that purchasing power or certainly increases the cost of the monthly mortgage. Now, when we look at rates over the last 5 years and just kind of give you a little glimpse looking back here. So in the tail end of 2020, we saw rates reach the all-time low, which is 2.625%. And then we can see kind of rates kind of come up a little bit here, and we kind of started moving north up closer to 3%. And then we stayed in about the low threes. Now in February of 2021, we saw rates push up to 3.25%. We thought, oh gosh, what's happening? But then rates kind of came back down, fell back into the threes, down to the twos. And then we kind of settled right in like around 3% for quite some time. And then, like I said, as of this year, we just saw rates really make a hard move upwards. So that's kind of currently what the state is right now. What's driving that is, you know, which many of you are hearing is just inflationary numbers, which is pushing interest rates up. The Federal Reserve has also started to pull back on some of the mortgage-backed security purchasing that they have been doing over the last few years. So that's obviously starting to push interest rates up quite a bit. In a high rate environment like this, and I shouldn't even say high rate, but a rising rate environment, the question comes quite often to us is that, you know, should I be looking at an adjustable rate mortgage? And for those of us that are first time home buyers, I really don't recommend that because adjustable rate mortgages have a fixed period of time, but after that time elapses, then the rate adjusts and then you have a fluctuating payment. This kind of graph here shows you kind of what the five-year fixed adjustable rate's been doing. And there certainly is a slightly lower at just over 4% versus a 30-year at the mid fives. But the trade-off is the volatility of that interest rate. So while I think it could be an answer for some clients, it's not certainly not an answer for all, especially in the first-time homebuyers. So we want to have more of a predictable payment that we can forecast into our budget. Okay. So I had a question come in. I just want to, okay. So, I'm not totally understand this question, but so a question came in, what is this interest rate for loans? It's bad. Okay, so the question was just, I think, just more around interest rates. Is it bad for buyers right now, just given the interest rate level? Well, I don't know if it's necessarily bad for buyers. I think ultimately it does change purchasing power. So the question is, you know, what do interest rates look like for when a buyer is ready to take the next steps in going out for the home search? Hopefully we'll see a little bit of leveling off in interest rates, but I think just this interest rate climate has changed maybe buyers' behaviors a little bit. So when we look at interest rates, it's not a one size fits all for interest rates. It varies by credit eligibility. Generally, when you have a 740 credit score or higher, you're going to be able to take advantage of the lowest available interest rates, loan product, how much you finance, what your down payment is. As we mentioned earlier, points or the cost to buy down a rate, that can change your rate option. And finally, term. So generally speaking, the lower your term is of your mortgage, the less expensive your interest rate is. So if I go from a 30-year fixed mortgage down to a 15-year fixed mortgage, that could potentially be a lower rate option. Okay. And it's our job as part of a consultation to design different financing options for you that helps you meet some of your goals or your financial goals with homeownership. And so we'll look at rate options as part of your consultation. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in just a bit. Now, part of what goes into your rate option is going to be credit. And credit's going to drive your program options, your rate offering, mortgage insurance costs. And so it's really important to have our clients best prepared from a credit perspective as well. Now, every loan program has different credit minimums. For example, the FHA loan, the minimum credit score is 580, conventional is 620, a VA loan is 620, and then the CalHFA loan, which we'll talk about a little bit later, is anywhere between 640 to 680. Okay, now there is a FICO score model or calculation. Now, many of you have different score tools, I guess, consumer tools that are available to you to help monitor your credit. Now there is three different models of credit. There's the mortgage model, auto, and there's the consumer credit model. So most of you that are monitoring your credit or getting that like through Credit Karma are getting get that through, or it's going to be part of the credit model. Now, as the mortgage financing goes, of course, we're going to use the mortgage score in qualifying and looking at that. Now here's the FICO score weighting. And so 15% of the score is going to be how long I've had credit. 20% is going to be how much credit I have in use or new credit I'm trying to obtain. So that's more around new credits that are going to appear on my credit report, but also hard inquiries. Now, in starting the process with us for your consultation, we're only going to do a soft inquiry, but hard inquiries is where we're going to be really aware of that, because hard inquiries can help and can bring down your credit score. With mortgage inquiries, you do have a 30-day window of time. So if you do inquire with a mortgage company, you have a 30-day clock to shop around with as many mortgage companies as you see fit. And that's the equivalent of one credit inquiry hit to your score. Now, the other 30% is how much I owe. That's simply put as revolving credit or utilization of credit. So when we look at utilization of credit, it's measuring my credit limit versus my credit balance. So if I have a $10,000 credit limit and I have $5,000 in credit balances, I'm at 50% utilization. If you're somewhat above that 50% utilization, I would encourage you to try to whittle that debt down below 50%. Once you've mastered that, we want to try to get that credit balances down below 10%. That's where you're going to start to optimize your credit score. Now, if you look at each of your credit cards, there's a billing cycle date on every credit account, because the billing cycle date is the date the account statement ends, and that information of whatever that balance is gets posted out to the credit reports, TransUnion, Equifax, Experian. And why that's an important date is because when that balance gets posted out to the credit bureaus, it can influence your credit score, good or bad, based upon your utilization. So what we like to teach our classes here is if you can try to manage to your billing cycle date versus your due date, you're going to be able to keep that balance down, hopefully lower, have a lower utilization to help improve your credit. So what I mean by that is if you have a due date on your American Express of, let's say, the 4th of the month, but your billing cycle closes out on the 20th of the month, what you want to try to do is pay down or pay off that balance before the 20th, because then when that balance posts out to the three agencies, you'll have hopefully that lower balance, improve your utilization, and have an ultimately higher credit score. The final component of the score weighting is going to be payment history. And that's simply put how well you're paying on your bills. Delinquencies are usually measured in 30, 60, and 90 plus delinquencies. So that's what we'll typically see on a credit report. Things like past challenges, bankruptcy, short sales, collections, like I said, late payments, those are going to impact you, especially if they've appeared in the last 12 to 24 months. So that most recent two-year period is going to be the most critical. Now, account closure is something you want to be mindful of. If you're in the habit of maybe doing balance transfers because you're trying to, you know, reap the benefits of a particular credit card, but then you close out your old credit card, you do want to be careful of that, because when you close out a credit card, it basically pulls away all the great history from that previous account, especially if you have some longstanding credit relationships. When we look at financing, we're always going to look at the middle credit score for a client. So if I'm applying individually and I have a 760, 740, and 720 score, we're going to look at the 740 score for qualifying. Now, if I'm applying with my partner and my partner has a 700, 680, and 660 score, we're going to use the 680 score because that's the lowest middle score between the two of us. Okay. That lowest middle score impacts our interest rate offering, product offering, as well as mortgage insurance. So again, credit plays a big role in determining what options we have for us in our purchasing. Now, when we look at negative items that are going to be on our credit, this is how long they're going to stay with us. Credit inquiries are usually 2 years on the report. Late payments, collections, judgments are 7 years or less. Public records like bankruptcies, 10 years or less. And then federal student loans can be on your report indefinitely. Now, the credit agencies just made a change. In fact, I announced this on our workshop last night. If you have medical collections, no longer will they be reporting on your credit report. I believe that's going to take place in the next week or so. So just something to be mindful of as you're monitoring your credit if you've had some challenges with medical collections. Student loans come up as we're doing consultations with our clients. And that's a really important part of qualifying for your mortgage, because student loan debt, while it's probably in forbearance, especially if it's federal student loan debt, we still have to take a look at it because it can impact your qualifying. There's usually two paths that we'll look at, programs we'll look at, and the calculation of student loans are different for each one of those. So we're gonna look at an FHA loan and a conventional loan this evening for the discussion. But generally, if I have, let's say, $75,000 in student loan debt, and even though it's in forbearance, whatever my income-based repayment amount was prior to the pandemic, that's what we will use for qualifying for your mortgage. Now, if you've never entered into an income-based repayment or have a minimum payment due, on a conventional loan, the default payment would be 1% of your balance or $750. Okay, so that's what would be used as a monthly obligation to qualify for your mortgage. Now, if you're doing an FHA loan and let's say you don't have an income-based repayment, the default is 0.5%. Okay, so that's just important to know, because we're going to factor that into a calculation called debt to income ratio, which you're going to learn a little bit more about in tonight's discussion. But student loans are something we're going to have to take a look at, even though they're in forbearance right now. Now, this also holds true that if you're in a deferred status because maybe you're back in school, then we're still going to have to count that payment. If you have a parent that's paying your student loans, we do have to verify 12 months of history of the parent making those student loan payments if we're going to exclude the student loan debt from your qualifying. Okay. So again, if they're in forbearance right now, we still have to count a minimum payment. If they're in deferment, that still holds true with the minimum payment. Another thing that comes up with student loans is, especially for our healthcare workers, if you have a forgivable component to your student loans because you're working in healthcare, even though they may be forgiven 2 or 3 years down the road, we still have to count a minimum obligation. All right, so let's kind of transition a little bit. I want to talk about loan programs. These are the five core programs that we want to be aware of as we're going down our path towards homeownership. There's the conventional loan, which we're going to talk more about the characteristics of the conventional loan just a bit. FHA loans, VA loans, those are going to be for our veterans that have served. That has a zero down payment option. USDA loans, now that's going to be for more of our rural areas, so the less densely populated areas. Which they're going to have some geographical restrictions, but also some income restrictions to USDA. For those of us in Southern California, they're going to be more kind of our outlying areas, more of our desert communities. Jumbo loans, those are going to be for our clients that are trying to purchase above a loan amount of $970,800. Generally, that requires 10 to 15% down payment. Now, with jumbo loans, something we want to be aware of is as we're creating our savings goals, we're going to save for our down payment, our closing costs. But jumbo loans also have another component of assets. It's called reserves. And reserves are additional funds that I have available that they're equivalent of generally 12 months of my monthly payment. And I need to have that kind of on hand. It's kind of just an emergency situation that I do have enough assets that if something was to go wrong financially for me, I do have the sustainability to be able to keep maintaining my mortgage. So let's say my mortgage payment was $5,000 a month and I have a 12-month reserve requirement. That means I would have to have $60,000 in assets set aside beyond my down payment, as well as my funds for my closing costs. Okay. So jumbo loans aren't common for our first time buyers, but I always like to kind of share some of those little, kind of tools and tips, I guess, if you will, on jumbo loans, because it's something that comes up a little more frequently. Now I want to kind of pay a little bit more attention to conventional and FHA loans, because 90% of our first time buyers are going to be using one of these two products. Conventional loans have a minimum down payment of 3%. That minimum down payment of 3% goes up to a loan amount of $647,200. And then if you finance more than $647,200 up to $970,800, that's for LA and Orange County, the down payment jumps from 3% to 5%. That's called a high balance loan. Now, if you're looking in the San Bernardino, Riverside market, maybe you're looking in Victorville, for example, the maximum loan amount in those communities is $647,200. But that still has a minimum down payment of 3%. Now with FHA loans, it's a 3.5% down minimum down payment. That is all the way up to $970,800 as well. And that's for the LA and Orange County markets. FHA loans go up to $647,200 though on some of our outlying counties. Now, when you put less than 20% down on a mortgage, there's a thing called private mortgage insurance or PMI. And so what we'd like to do in our workshops is kind of explain the difference between looking at PMI on a conventional loan versus PMI on an FHA loan. So let's look at conventional really quick. And so with a conventional loan, the PMI has a few different payment options. You can pay it monthly. You can split the MI between monthly and maybe some of it upfront. That's called split MI. There's single premium where you would basically buy out the cost of the mortgage insurance at the origination of your loan. Or you can do what we call lender paid mortgage insurance. And that's where you take a slightly higher interest rate. That interest rate differential helps to buy out the mortgage insurance. Now, mortgage insurance on conventional loans have kind of three key components that make up the cost of mortgage insurance. It's kind of like car insurance, right? Think about car insurance. The fancier your car is, the more kind of high risk it is, maybe to be higher propensity for accidents or maybe to be broken into. So those characteristics are what makes up your auto premium. Very similar to what it looks like for PMI. So, but PMI for a mortgage is based upon your credit score. So higher your credit score, down payment, and then how much you finance. So higher my credit score is less down payment, less amount finance, the cheaper my mortgage insurance premium can be. Now, generally, your mortgage insurance has a cancellation option. When you have at least 2 years and 22% equity in the home, you can apply with your mortgage servicer to have your mortgage insurance canceled. And that's a nice kind of characteristic to have, because if the market starts to continue to go up in interest rates, and at some point when you have that equity, you want to be able to contact your servicer to cancel your mortgage insurance, not have to be forced into a refinance to be able to cancel the mortgage insurance. Now, if we look at conventional mortgage insurance, you know, roughly speaking, if you finance $450,000, the PMI for 3% down with a 740 credit score is just right about $183 a month. If you're looking at some of the calculators offered on Zillow or Redfin, you'll probably see some of the calculators showing maybe twice that amount in monthly mortgage insurance. But those calculators generally don't have like all the characteristics built into them, like credit score and program types and whatnot. So just something to keep in mind. I will say our APM mobile app has a great calculator function on it. It's all set up with the mortgage insurance pricing tiers. So really encouraging me to download that after tonight's discussion. That'd be really helpful for you in your home shopping. Now, FHA loans have mortgage insurance. Now, whether you put 20% down or 3.5% down, mortgage insurance is going to be required on an FHA loan. Mortgage insurance has two components. It has monthly mortgage insurance, which is 0.85% of your loan amount. And then we divide that by 12. There's also upfront mortgage insurance, and that gets added onto your amount finance. Now with FHA mortgage insurance, you can't cancel the mortgage insurance unless you refinance. So you no longer do you have that cancellation option like you do with a conventional loan. And finally, with FHA mortgage insurance, the cost differential is quite a bit higher because not only are you going to have the upfront mortgage insurance of, in this case, like $7,800, as you can see here on our example, but you also have monthly mortgage insurance. And so as we're looking at our different product offerings, we want to keep that in mind. Now, you may ask yourself, you know, why would I go with FHA versus conventional? Because clearly it's more expensive and I don't get the cancellation option, all that. Well, as we saw in our credit slide, the minimum credit scores are a lot lower for FHA. And as it relates to maybe past credit challenges we've had, maybe a bankruptcy, which FHA will allow you to, you know, purchase in 2 years, conventional would ask you to have a 4-year seasoning period. Or maybe you had a foreclosure back in the days, FHA would ask you to be only 4 years out of the foreclosure, where conventional would ask for 7 years. So the different aspects of the guidelines will kind of really direct us as to what's the best possible solution for you as a client, okay? So here's the loan limits for this year. Now these loan limits get updated every year. So right around November, we post the new loan limits. Those are all set by Fannie Mae and FHA. But this is what it looks like for all of our counties in Southern California. So you can kind of choose a county that fits for your home buying plan. Okay, from an income perspective, in qualifying for your mortgage, there's certain documentation that we're gonna ask for. As a W-2 wage earner, we're generally gonna ask for last 2 years of W-2s, 30 days worth of pay stubs, and then we're gonna verify your employment either in written and or verbal form, okay? Now, if you're self-employed, it's gonna look a little bit different. We're definitely gonna want the last 2 years of taxes. We're gonna need a profit and loss statement and some type of balance sheet. And then we're gonna verify the business through a business license and or a CPA letter. So that's pretty much what we'll ask for as part of the documentation for your pre-approval. Now, when we look at income, there's a couple things that come up as frequently asked questions from clients. And one of the things is relating to work history. Then the question is generally is, do I have to be on my job 2 years or do I have to have 2 years work history to qualify for a mortgage? And the rule is I need to have 2 years of work history and or education. So if I, you know, went to Long Beach the last 4 years, got my degree in accounting, and now I just got hired on at Deloitte to work in the accounting field, because I have my 4 years undergrad and now I'm going to work in the accounting field, that would satisfy my 2 year requirement. Okay. Now, if I'm looking to switch jobs, so now I'm moving on to a different career, I don't necessarily have to have a certain amount of time on that next job. We can actually qualify you. If you're in transition, getting ready to start a new job, we can actually qualify you with an executed offer letter. So that's an option for you as well. Now, if you have dual employment, so let's say I'm working in the healthcare industry and I have a job at 30 hours a week at one clinic, 20 hours at another. In order to count both sources of income, I do have to demonstrate that I've been on both jobs continuously for 2 years. That rule also holds true for part-time work. So if I'm working part-time, I have to show that I've been doing that 2 years to be able to count that income. For clients that maybe are working a full-time job, but they're also driving for Uber, if they want to include that Uber income, because technically it's 1099 income, we have to show that they've been driving for Uber for 2 years along with doing their full-time position in order to count both sources of income. Okay. And then just, you know, a question that comes up is just, and I'm kind of going back to my statement around offer letters and stuff. So if you do have an offer letter and you haven't quite started your job yet, you can potentially get qualified for a mortgage as long as we have the offer letter. And basically the rule is you would have to get your first paycheck from your new employer before your first mortgage payment is due on your financing. So with income, we're also gonna look at your obligations versus your income. It's a calculation called debt to income ratio or DTI. You've probably heard of that formula before, but ultimately what it does, it takes your pre-tax income versus your monthly obligations. And there's a requirement for lenders that debt to income ratio does not exceed more than 45%. And you know, it's a tool that we use for qualifying, but doesn't just necessarily dictate affordability. Affordability is going to kind of be factored in as we kind of go through a consultation with you, just to figure out like where you're at from a rental perspective now, what's it going to look like in housing? Because you know, it's really important that we design home buying options that are going to fit your budget, not necessarily where you're going to qualify at. Nonetheless, here's the debt to income ratio calculation. So we take into consideration the mortgage principal interest, the property taxes, the homeowner's insurance. We take the PMI or private mortgage insurance. And then if you're going to buy a condo, maybe you're going to buy a townhouse, there will be HOA fees assessed with that. So then we have to factor that in. And let's just assume that's $2,500 a month for this discussion. Now, if I have that coupled with my other debts like student loans, car loans, maybe credit cards, and those total $500 a month, if I take that $3,000 in obligations divided by my $8,500 in gross monthly income, I'm going to come out to about a 35.29% debt to income ratio. Now, the maximum that most lenders can lend at is 45% debt to income ratio, where most first-time buyers feel comfortable at is right around 36%. So that's really where we see most of our first-time buyers. 33 to 36% is really kind of where we see kind of the sweet spot, if you will. Okay, we had a question that came in, so I just want to answer it on air. So the question is, if you're moving back to California from out of state and your out of state income is less than what it would be in California, how would that work in essence? So we're going to take current income when it comes to qualifying. So it's not going to be your historical. The only time we'll use historical if you're a W-2 employee is if we're trying to average like bonus income or commission income. And so that's what that'll typically look like. If you're self-employed, we're always going to do a two-year average of the income for calculating the income. One question's come up quite often, and we can revisit this again as we talk about first-time buyer programs. But for some of the assistance programs that are offered, we're always going to use current income, not necessarily historical income. So if I just got a raise, if I made $100,000 a year last year, and now today I just got a raise, now I'm making $105,000 for the year, that's the income that we're going to use for qualifying, specific to assistance programs. Let's talk a little bit about down payment because, you know, as we look at some of the key components of purchasing a home, having our savings goals met is important. So we want to make sure that we understand, you know, what assets we have available can be used for financing. So obviously checking in savings accounts, we're going to want to see the last 2 months of statements. Unfortunately, cash cannot be used for financing. And so we got to make sure that we can paper trail all of our assets being used for financing. Any large deposits, we're going to have to make sure we know, understand the originating source of those. Of course, retirement accounts can be used, 401ks, 403bs, IRAs. So you can take a loan against your 401k or your 403b that can be used. Not always the number one option. So I think we should talk through that a little bit as part of your consultation. IRAs, you definitely want to talk to your financial or tax advisor because that can create a tax event by withdrawing those funds. And then gift funds can be used, and that's where a family member would help with down payment or closing costs. There is no seasoning requirement for gift funds. Those can be done right away, whereas other assets can be or have to be seasoned at least 60 days. Okay. I'm going to backtrack a little bit. Just to our income question, I think it was income question. We'll just answer this on air. So the question is, if you're a freelancer, so you're in the film TV industry and you work for different companies all the time with breaks in between W-2 or 1099, how does that work? So that's a good question that does come up with a lot of our clients in Southern California. Generally speaking, when you're working with multiple employers, we're gonna do an average of the income that we've had accrued for the W-2 perspective. And then the 1099s will flow into a Schedule C. So then we'll average the 2 years for Schedule C. So it is more of a case by case. Hopefully there's a little more consistency with employers you're receiving W-2s from, but that may be something we're going to want to talk a little bit offline. But generally speaking, we're going to have to probably 2 year average the W-2 income, 2 year average the net income from the 1099. Okay. And then how about... Okay, and then just another question came in about how about foreign income transfer converted to U.S. dollars? So can we use foreign income for qualifying? That depends it just depends on your employment source for foreign income. So I think that one we probably want to, you know, look at more of kind of a one-on-one consultation because those options vary by the employer, the type of product that you're going to apply for, and kind of what that makeup is over your overall income. Okay. All right. Good questions. All right. So we just covered the asset section of buying. And so when we think about home purchasing, as I work with clients across the state, there's usually kind of two hurdles or challenges, if you will. It's usually either credit, because maybe our credit's not quite there where we want to be able to purchase. But more often than not, we just maybe have a lack of resources when it comes to down payment. And so, you know, when we look at different options here, you know, CalHFA, sorry, I got our slides a little mixed around here, but CalHFA is a partner of ours that we're really proud to work with. CalHFA is the California Housing Finance Agency, designed to help low to moderate income households. And so as being the leading provider of CalHFA, we love to share some of the assistance programs that are available to help you fill the gap when it comes to down payment or closing costs for your home purchase. Now, just a couple of weeks ago, we launched the Forgivable Equity Builder Loan. So if those of you who are watching ABC News Channel 7, I think there was a big spotlight on that there. If you're joining us from the Bay Area, San Jose Mercury did a big write-up on CalHFA. Because CalHFA just launched the Equity Builder Program, which is noted here. It's designed to help low-income housing families that make less than 80% of the median income with up to 10% in forgivable assistance towards their home purchase. Now, the key component of this program is you do have to make less than 80% of the median income, which in LA County is $68,880. I do realize that's a lower level as I meet with clients throughout the day. Those income limits change every year, especially with the cost of living. I think we're going to see a much higher income number. We don't know what that number is going to be yet, but over the next couple of months, hopefully we'll see something that gets rolled out. But the Equity Builder can be a fantastic solution to be able to help our low-income housing clients. Now, again, it's 10% of your purchase price. So as long as you stay in the property for 5 years, first of all, it's interest-free. But if you stay in the property for 5 years, the assistance is completely forgiven. So let's say I buy a $400,000 house, my down payment of $40,000 would be supplemented by the state, and we can also add additional funds on top of that. So if I have saved up $20,000, I could use that in combination with the $40,000 provided through the state. Now, it can't be combined with some of the other state assistance programs, which we're going to talk about in just a second. There's the My Home and the ZIP program. But for those clients that fit the criteria of the Equity Builder program, it's a fantastic solution. The Equity Builder does require a minimum credit score of 640 for clients using the government loans like FHA loans, or 660 for a conventional loan. Okay, so that's designed to help our clients making less than 80% of the median income, and of course, first-time buyers. Now, there's other solutions offered through CalHFA, through our moderate income households. And these are kind of the core products that we've been offering with CalHFA for the last several years. But the My Home product and the ZIP product, well, first of all, the My Home product can help with your down payment. And then the ZIP program can help with closing costs. Now, as you learned earlier in our program segment, the minimum down payment for a conventional loan is 3%. The My Home assistance can help fill that void of 3% on a conventional loan, and then 3.5% if you elect to do an FHA loan. Now, the difference with the forgivable equity and the My Home product is it is a low interest loan at 1%. But the great thing about it is you don't have to pay back this assistance until you either sell your home or if you refinance in the future. Okay, so it's a really cool option. Now, that can help satisfy your down payment requirement. And then there's also closing cost assistance, and that's through the ZIP assistance program. Up to 2-3% of your loan amount in assistance. It's interest-free, and you don't have to pay it back until you either sell or refinance. So that's a great tool as well to help lower your total out-of-pocket expense. Now, one question that comes up often is, can I elect to do the ZIP assistance over the My Home because it's interest-free? And you actually have to take the My Home first, and then if you need additional support with your closing costs, then you can elect to have the ZIP assistance. Now, the more assistance you take, potentially the higher your interest rate can be on your mortgage. So you really want to be mindful of that. Interest rates on these programs range from 5.25% up to 6%. Of course, the average interest rate is about 5.5% right now. So, you know, these loans will adjust according to where the market's at. Let's look at a quick example of how we would apply this for a client. So let's say I was buying a $500,000 property. we know that my minimum down payment is going to be $15,000 or 3%, right? Now, we also have closing costs, which are anywhere between 2 to 3% of my sales price. So that's $10,000 to $15,000. So if I didn't have an assistance program, I would probably need $25,000 to $30,000 out of pocket, right? Now, if I want to take and incorporate CalHFA conventional into my financing, I could get my home assistance would cover my entire down payment. So I'd have the $15,000 covered there. Plus I could get anywhere between 2 to 3% of my loan amount for closing cost assistance and use these assistance funds to help offset this closing cost estimate. So now maybe instead of bringing that $25,000 to $30,000 out of pocket, maybe I'm looking at $4,000 to $5,000 out of pocket. And when we start looking at those numbers, those can be much more attainable from some of our first-time buyers. This product is not designed for all first-time buyers, but certainly gives you another solution. If you're really struggling to try to be able to create enough savings for yourself, it can be maybe that little extra, you know, support that can help get to the home buying finish line. This is what the same scenario would look like on FHA. So the same logic applies. You would have the 3.5% my home, plus you would have 2 to 3% of your loan amount for closing cost assistance. Okay. So there is some borrow eligibility factors. I think we had a question that came up. This will probably answer this. There is a minimum score of 640 for government loans. 660 is going to be the minimum for a conventional loan. If you qualify on the Equity Builder program, it's 680 if you make above 80% of the AMI. Now, there is a debt to income ratio requirement, 45%. And for the income qualifications, this is really important. The income is based upon the applicants only. It's not the household size. And this comes up quite a bit, especially as I'm taking calls on the Equity Builder program. So the way this works is that if I'm earning $60,000 a year and my spouse is earning $50,000 a year, but we only apply in just my name, we only look at the $60,000 to meet, you know, the qualifying income limits. Now, that being said, we know there's $110,000 in income in the household. So if your expenses are reflective of $110,000 income, it may be difficult to qualify at $60,000. So we'll have to take a look at that, but that is one option you can consider and to fall within the income limits if you have a higher household income. The maximum income on this program, specific to the My Home and Zip program, is $158,000 in Long Beach. I believe it's like $220,000 in the Orange County market. For those of you that may be joining us from up in the Bay Area, there's other income limits. So it's all based upon by county. Now, a first-time buyer is someone that hasn't owned in the last 3 years. Okay, so if you sold a house in 2010, you've been renting ever since, you're still considered a first-time buyer. If you have a rental property in Texas, but you've been renting in Long Beach for the last 5 years, you're still considered a first-time buyer. So it's basically means someone has continuously rented as a primary residence for the last 3 years. Now, this program is eligible for single-family homes, new constructions allowed. You can do condos, townhouses, even below market homes are eligible. Manufactured homes can be eligible, but it has to be on loan that's land that's actually owned. It can't be like in a park. Okay, here's some of the income limits for some of our surrounding counties in Southern California. So like I said, Orange County is the highest in the Southern California market at 211,000. And you can see the other respective counties. Okay, so that's the CalHFA assistance program. That's something we can obviously take a look at as part of an upcoming consultation for you. Now, I want to take you through our 6 steps of home buying. And these are the different milestones we'll go through in the home buying purchase process. So the first one is pre-approval. And you may have heard about this in kind of doing your research online. A pre-approval is a certificate that you receive from us, the lender, indicating that you're eligible for your financing. Usually that pre-approval is good for 60 days. And you will take that pre-approval to use in submitting an offer to a seller. Now that pre-approval, even though it's only good for 60 days, we can always recertify at any time, doesn't require you to reapply or anything. We may just need to get some updated documentation for you during that certification process. Now that is step one. Now that's the output of a consultation with us. So we'll do a consultation where we put together a comprehensive home buying game plan. The output is the pre-approval. And then the next step is gonna be house hunting. That's where we get a chance to go out and look at different properties that maybe fit our budget. You'll want to connect with a realtor at that time. We do have preferred realtors that we work with across California. So once you're done with your pre-approval and you want to get connected with one of our trusted realtor partners, we can certainly make that introduction. Now, as you're looking at different homes, that pre-approval letter can be updated at any time. to match whatever is your offer price, as long as it meets within your qualifying parameters. So that's step two, which is house hunting. Now, if we find a few homes that we like, we go out and tour them and we find a house that just fits what we're looking for, then we would submit an offer on that home. If that offer gets accepted by a seller, then we move to the next milestone. That's called step three, or entering escrow. So that means a seller has accepted our offer and we've started the escrow process. Now, the escrow process is usually 21 to 30 days. So from the time of acceptance to all the way at step six, when I get my keys, it takes about 21 to 30 days. Within 2 to 3 days of that acceptance, you'll be required to make an earnest money deposit. The earnest money deposit is usually 1 to 2% of your overall sales price. Now, for those of you that are going to elect maybe an assistance program, that assistance will help towards down payment and closing costs, but it won't contribute towards the earnest money deposit. With that said, that earnest money deposit will go towards your total out-of-pocket expense, but that is going to be something you're going to want to budget into your home buying, is 1 to 2% of your purchase price and the ability to be able to pay that upfront. Now, that earnest money deposit, as you're going to learn in just a minute, is protected in escrow. So the seller doesn't get access to those funds until the close of escrow period. Within a few days of your acceptance, we're going to schedule you for a follow-up video call. That's where we're going to get a chance to review your options for you. We'll order your appraisal on your house. Your realtor will order some inspections on your home. And finally, after your follow-up consultation has been completed, we'll send out disclosures to you for your review. That follow-up consultation that we do is designed to review your interest rate options, payment scenarios, out-of-pocket expenses, just so you can really understand what your overall financing is going to look like for the home purchase. As I mentioned about the earnest money deposit, that's going to be 1 to 2% of your purchase price. That money is held in escrow. Seller does not get access to that, but it does contribute towards your total out-of-pocket expense. That earnest money deposit is held in escrow as part of the contingency period. So, and the contingency period allows you to do your due diligence on the property, which includes getting the house appraised, getting your house inspected, and then overall getting your loan approved. Now, the contingency period is usually in the first 14 to 17 days of your contract period. Why that's important to you is not only your deposit protected and you get to do your due diligence, but if something just doesn't add up for you in the home purchase, maybe there's bad inspections or the house just isn't what you expected, you can potentially cancel your contract and get a full refund. So the contingency period will generally go from step three all the way to step five. Now, step four is going to be processing and underwriting. That's where we get a chance to verify your employment, your assets. We'll get any additional documentation that's needed so we can move to underwriting. Your interest rate gets locked prior to that step, and you'll have that information available to you during your follow-up consultation. And like I said, we'll submit everything to our underwriting team, who will issue your loan approval at step five. And when we get to step five in the process, you're generally going to be about 3/4 of the way through the home buying process. You'll also be at the end of your contingency period. So if everything is all good with the inspections, your appraisal, your loan approval, then you'll sign off on your contingency. And that tells the seller that you're ready to move to the final stages of the process. Now, if you sign off on your contingency and then maybe you get second thoughts and you want to cancel 2 days later, you got to be careful because you could risk losing your deposit. So you just want to make sure that you've done all your homework, you feel good about the house before you remove your contingency. And finally, at step five, we're going to issue to you a final closing disclosure. And that's going to give you a 3-day cooling off period before you get to the very final stage called closing your loan. And that's where you sign final documents in person with a public notary. Any funds that you still need in your home purchasing experience will be deposited at that time. On the lending side, we'll go ahead and wire in the funds for the mortgage, the assistance programs if you've elected that. And once that money has been reconciled by the escrow officer, they'll record documents with the county recorder's office. They record a grant deed to transfer ownership to you, and then they also record a deed of trust. And so once they get confirmation of those recording items, then you become the official owner of the home, get a chance to high-five your realtor, get a chance to go out and get your keys to your house and celebrate, because it's going to be a huge accomplishment for you in getting that journey towards homeownership or through homeownership. Now, if you just as a footnote here, if you elect the CalHFA assistance program, there is required training. It's 8 hours of online class. Generally, we recommend that you start taking that class by the time you get to step three in the process. Okay, so that's our 6 steps of home buying. And if that kind of process was helpful to you and you kind of really want to figure out what this all looks like for you, We really encourage you to connect with us either for an intro call, just to kind of go over some questions maybe that didn't get covered on tonight's call, or if you're ready to kind of get started with putting together a home buying game plan, we'd love to be able to connect with you for a consultation. And how we start this process is you would submit an online application, which we have the link set here. We only do a soft credit pull as part of that application. You'll upload proof of your assets, your income, and then after that's completed, you'll schedule a consultation here with us. And that consultation is done either via video or over phone. And that's where we kind of build a comprehensive home buying game plan for you. And as you heard in the six steps of home buying, the output of that consultation will be to have you pre-approved. Now, here's what the framework of that consultation looks like. Talks about your housing budget. We'll do some goal setting with you. We'll talk about location and affordability. We'll look at your overall loan application of rates, costs. We'll review credit. In fact, if you need a credit plan, we'll help you out with that. We'll go back through those six steps of home buying, and then hopefully we'll be in a position where we have the home buying game plan designed and we can issue that pre-approval letter to you. So that's what a consultation looks like. I mentioned a little bit more about the mobile app earlier tonight in the workshop. So this is a great tool for you. You can download that for Apple or Android. You can submit your application right there, do the calculation use the calculator if you want. You can upload documents. You can even follow the progress of your loan application right through mobile. As you heard earlier, I mean, we're really excited about our partnership with Long Beach State and our alumni and staff. And so we pass along our $750 discount in closing costs as part of our partnerships. We also have other partnerships throughout California. So maybe if you're joining us through one of those other partnerships, we'll still pass along that same discount. And you know, we have access with our free consultations that we do for those home buying game plans and these workshops that we give to the community every couple of weeks. So you're always more than welcome to join those classes. In fact, if you have friends, family, even coworkers that want to attend these classes, they're more than welcome to join. And you know, throughout the process, we want to be your trusted mortgage advisor, because like I said earlier, this is probably going to be one of the largest investments you're going to make in your lifetime. Here's our class schedule that's coming up. Obviously, you're attending the May 18th Long Beach class, but we have classes next week, and we actually have a class in Virginia. So if those of you that have friends or family in Virginia, they can take that class. And then we'll take a little bit of a break, and then we'll be back on the schedule in July. So love to be able to have you have some friends or family attend those workshops. Here's my my contact information. If you need to reach out to me for any follow-up questions from tonight's discussion, you can email, message me, call me. Or like I said, if you want to schedule one of those intro calls, we can certainly do that, or a consultation. And since we've been doing our workshops over the last 8 years, we have so many different graduates that have gone on to achieve home ownership. We love to celebrate that on our social channels. So I really encourage you to check out some of our testimonials on our social channels, but also on our Google and Yelp reviews. And in our social channels, we really try to post good content. So really encourage you to follow us on Instagram or Facebook. You know, we're posting generally every Friday, at least some tips and resources around home buying or changes that, that come about in the market. As things change with maybe income limits or product offerings, you'll definitely be able to find out in some of our social channels. So with that said, I really appreciate all of you joining us this evening. I know everybody has a busy schedule, but taking the time out to learn about home ownership and all the great things that can happen with home ownership. Hopefully this information was helpful for you in looking and discovering what could be for you in the future with homeownership. So we're going to go ahead and stay online for a little bit. If we have any follow-up questions to answer for the group, we'll do that. And then we'll go ahead and wrap up tonight's discussion. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and put on mute for a second and then see if we have any questions, and then I'll go ahead and sign off.